Okay, so we return to this topic of deductive retrieval. And we want to look at with an alternate approach, which is backward chaining. So, let us first recall what we have studied so far. So far we have looked at forward chaining. And what forward chaining did was that given a knowledge base which contains some facts. So, let us say these small circles represent facts and rules. Whatever inferences we could make, we go ahead and make essentially. So, if you can somehow add a new sentence to the knowledge base, you add it, you add another new sentence. So, you keep adding new sentence. So, obviously you can see that this is kind of a uncontrolled process. And the hope is that if you want to prove a sentence alpha, let us say it is here, that eventually you will end up adding that essentially. Now, you can see that the number of inferences that you can make is proportional in some sense to the size of the knowledge base. The more of the facts and rules that you have, the more the new facts and rules you can add. So, it kind of tends to grow rapidly. And you are only hoping that at some point you will end up adding the fact alpha to that essentially. So, you can say forward chaining is eager as some people call it assertion time. And by this we mean that if you can make an inference, go ahead and make it essentially. Whenever you assert a fact and if that fact leads to some new facts, infer the facts. Of course, you may be constrained by the fact that you can do only one inference at a time. So, you may have to choose a particular strategy, and we saw that when we looked at this language OPS5 and the RetainNet, that it allowed us to use some sort of a conflict resolution strategy. We decided which rule to apply to which fact, but that is a different matter essentially. But essentially you make whatever inferences you can make, and the hope is that eventually you will make the inference that you are interested in, which is this sentence alpha that we want to generate essentially. So, this is also data driven, right. Now, what we want to look at is this process of backward chaining, which is in contrast lazy. So, the evaluation is lazy essentially, which means it is query time. Whenever you want a certain formula, you want to query about a certain formula, then only you make start doing the inferences essentially. It is also as opposed to data driven, it is also goal directed. That another word that we often use is teleological. Goal oriented, trying to achieve a certain goal essentially. So, if you remember what forward chaining, the basic idea behind forward chaining was that we used modified modus ponens rules. We said that if you have let us say beta implies gamma and if you are given beta prime, and if you can unify them with some substitution theta, then from this infer gamma into theta, apply that substitution to gamma and you get theta essentially. So that is data driven. So you are moving from the antecedents of the rule towards the consequent essentially. In backward chaining, what we do is from, so if you want to say that we have a query, let us say in this case this query is alpha that we were interested in, and we will write this by saying that show alpha essentially, or we can write it by saying goal alpha. So if we have a goal alpha, which means we want to show that alpha is true, then we say that if we have a rule, let us say again of the same kind, beta implies gamma, and if you can unify alpha and gamma, again let us say with theta, then from this you say show beta theta essentially, or you can say that the goal is beta theta essentially. So in some sense this was a query or goal, and this is a sub query or sub goal. So let me illustrate this with our favorite example, which said that man X implies mortal X, and let us say we had certain facts in our knowledge base which said that, as we have been talking, man, Socrates, then our goal is mortal Socrates. Then you can see that we can unify this with this by saying X equal to Socrates, and we can reduce it to a sub goal, man Socrates, and this sub goal we obtain by applying this substitution X equal to Socrates to the left hand side of the antecedent, and so we have a goal man Socrates. And if we can find a goal sentence in the knowledge base, we stop essentially. So that is the termination criteria essentially. So in backward chaining we are moving from the consequent to the antecedent essentially. The interesting thing is that we can extend this idea to existential queries. So we can say that our goal is, let me first write it in first order logic, that there exists an X mortal X. This is the kind of queries that you make typically with databases essentially. Is there an employee who has been working for 3 years and whose salary is more than 10,000 rupees, then you want to retrieve answers to that. That is why we call it deductive retrieval in this case essentially. Now the thing about our existential query is that we will reverse the Skolemization convention. Our Skolemization convention so far was that universally quantified variables will be marked with a question mark followed by the variable name, but for goals we will reverse this convention and say that this thing stands for existential. Which means that we will express this query as mortal x. So, remember that now this question mark x stands for an existential query. So, we are not saying that show that everybody is mortal, we are saying that is there someone who is mortal, is there some x which is mortal essentially. Now, you can see that with this query and with this same fact, we can now have a sub query or sub goal man x. So, it happens that I have used the same variable name, but ideally I should have used a different variable name and then you would have said for example, y is equal to x or something like that, but it does not matter I think as long as you remember that that should be done. So, we have a sub query called man x essentially. So, again we look into our database and we see that yes, there is a sentence of the kind man Socrates and we can answer yes to this. So, in the first case we can return an answer saying yes. In the second case with an existential query we can return an answer yes again that yes, the sentence is true that there exists an x such that x is mortal, but we can also say that x is equal to Socrates. We can return a value essentially. So, instead of man Socrates, if we had another sentence which said that man father let us say Suresh, then if we had to match this with this, then our answer would be yes. Father of Suresh is mortal. Remember the query, original query was is there someone who is mortal? We could have answered yes, Suresh's father is mortal or Socrates is mortal and things like that. So, we can work with existential queries and return answers to that essentially. The interesting thing is we can now extend this ability to do something which we can call as programming. So, let us take an example. Append two lists. You are given two lists and you want to write a program to append those two lists essentially. So, for example, if you are given the list, we will use the square bracket to represent list that this is a list, you must return an appended list which is this is a list. So, this is a task you can you may have written a program to append two lists essentially, there are various ways of doing that essentially. What we do with logic is that we are saying, okay, so what we do when we are working with logic is that we give a logical description. Of what does it mean to append essentially, and we can we do that by by defining sentences. So how do we do that? So in the case of append, we say that this sentence is true, append let me call it x 1. So our schema is append list 1, list 2, list 3, where this is list 3, this is list 2, this is list 1. So our predicate append is true if the first and the second list together give you the third list. So if I say append A B C D A B C D, then it is true. If I say something like append B C A D, then this is false. So that is the meaning of the predicate append, that it will be true if the first argument appended to the second argument gives you the third argument as a list and all the three arguments are list. And this one statement that we have written about append says that if you append the empty list with any list which we have called x 1, then you get x 1 essentially, which is obviously a true statement because you append an empty list to a list, you get the first list back essentially. The second sentence that we write is that if you were to append x y to give you z, then okay. So I need to introduce a little bit of notation here. We will represent a list by cons pairs. Okay, so there is this notion called cons pair notation, which is how internally lists are represented, and this cons word comes from the language Lisp. So if you have studied the language Lisp, then you know that there is an operator called cons which takes two arguments, the cons head and tail. So a list will always be represented by cons head with tail. So if I have a list like made of B and C, then it would be represented as an element B here followed by an element C here followed by nil. So the list BC would be represented as cons of B with cons of C with nil. So a cons is a pair essentially, it tells you which is a head and which is a tail, and in this tree that you see here there are two cons pairs, each has a left hand side and the right hand side. The left hand side is points to the head of the list, the right hand side points to the tail of the list essentially. And for this second cons pair, the head is C and the tail is empty list. So the list containing B C is essentially stored as cons B cons C nil essentially. So with that definition we can now write this append, which says that if you can append x to y to give you z, then you can append something preceding x. So, cons something, let us call it a x with the same y to give you what you originally got preceded by the same a essentially. So, cons a z. This is obviously a true formula, because what I am saying here is, for example, if I have this one append, let us say 1 comma 2 comma 5 comma 6 gives me 1 comma 2 comma 5 comma 6. This means that if I were to put anything before 1 in the first list, so let us say 8, then this would also be true. 8 comma 1 comma 2 5 comma 6 8 comma 1 comma 2 comma 5 comma 6. So that is my second formula. So I have two formulas here. First formula says that if you take an empty list and append it to something, you will get that. The second formula says that if you can append x with y to give you z, then if you had something before x, if you had sort of const something to x, which is in this example the element 8. So I have added 8 to the list 1 2, so I get 8 1 2. Then all I have to do is to add 8 to the resulting list that I got in the previous time, it was 1 2 5 6. Now I just simply say 8 1 2 5 6. Now this is obviously a true formula, you can look at it and see that it is true. The interesting thing about using logic is that this is a program. To attend append to list, and this kind of programs are called logic programs, and this whole approach to programming is called logic programming. And essentially it was shown by Robert Kowalski, who worked in Imperial College London. This is around 1970 something. He showed that logic and theorem proving or reasoning can be seen as an exercise in programming, and in fact it can be seen as a programming language. And between him and Kolmogorov, who was working in France, they devised a language Prolog, which is now a commonly used language essentially. Now let us see how this can be used to as a logic program essentially. So let us try and append to list to do that eventually. So, in the style of Prolog, so we will write the consequent followed by antecedent. And we will assume that we are working with only one type of formulas in which the consequent is atomic and the antecedent is a conjunct. Of atomic formulas. So, you can say A and B and C implies D and things like that. On the antecedent side you can have many atomic formulas, on the consequent side you are allowed only one, and a little bit later in the course we will see why that is the case essentially. Now, why do we make this restriction essentially? It is basically for computational reasons that it turns out to be more efficient. So, we will write our logic rules in this format now. So, the first one is as before, there is no antecedent there. So, it is just a simple formula, nil x 1 if I append nil to something, I will get the thing back essentially. The second one, I will write the consequent first, append, and those of you who have used Prolog will see that there is a similarity between the way we are writing things here. So, I am using the arrow symbol here just to distinguish it from the earlier one. It is the same rule, I am just rewriting it. And let us say that our goal now is an existential goal. That is this formula true, append, this is a so instead of giving the third argument, I have said can I find a value for this variable r such that the append formula will become true. So, logically that is the question I am asking. Can I find a substitution which will make this formula a true formula? And the only way I can make a formula true is by either the first clause or the second clause. It should either match the first clause or if it matches the head of the second clause. So, this would we will call as a head and this we will call as a body. If you can match the head, then you can move to the body essentially in some sense. We will come back to this terminology in the next class again. I just want to finish this example now essentially. So, what do? We call our good old unification algorithm and we say that can you unify this with anything in my knowledge base. The knowledge base contains these two sentences and when you say unify, we basically mean to the left hand side essentially. So, either the fact or the head of a statement. So, you cannot unify this with 1 because 1 says that append nil with something and you cannot unify nil with the list called this is essentially. Now, remember that this list this is stored as cons this cons is nil. This notation, this cons pair notation, because that allows this recursion to take place more easily. Now, we can match this with the second clause. So, matches 2 and the substitution is that A is this, right. If I put A as this, maybe I will keep circling them as I do that. Then x is equal to cons is nil. So, that is the second thing that I have managed to match. I will not bother to match the second part which is that of y. So, we will just write that as y is equal to a list. You can write it in cons pairs, it does not really matter. Then we will say that let us say z matches cons is no sorry So, let us say we will rename z as z 1 for some reason, just to make life simple for us, and we will say that this variable r now matches cons a, we have already said is this z 1 actually. So, what have I done? I have matched this variable r with this whole thing here, and I just renamed z on the way essentially. So, you should go back and verify that yes, you can match this formula with the consequent, and therefore, according to the backward chaining rule, we get a sub goal which is append. I am left with only is, which I will write now as cons is nil with a list. I will just rewrite this in the this thing, and now since I replace it, I will call this z 1 essentially. So, I have a new goal now that append cons is nil with z 1 essentially, and I will leave this as a small exercise for you to show that the next sub goal from this is. So, we have in the second rule you can see cons a x, and in our goal we have cons is comma nil. So, a will match is and x will match nil, and then likewise instead of z 1 we might have z 2 or something like that, but I will get a new goal which is append. Now, is will go, just see in the first call this vanished from the sentence and I was left with only the is part. In the second call is will also vanish, so I will be left only with the nil part. And let us say z 2, and the thing is that z 1 is equal to cons is z 2. So, you should verify that with this substitution where z 1 is cons as z 2, you eventually boil down to a goal which says is this formula true, that appending nil with a list called a list will give me some variable called z 2. Now, obviously, since z 2 is a variable, it will be indeed true, and then the first clause will match append nil with x 1 comma x 1, both x 1 will match both a list and z 2 will also match a list. So, when you say this equal to this, then you can see that as a consequence. So, let me write this in a different color here. This will become a list will come here. So, this will become cons is cons a cons list nil, which in other words it is not very clear here, but it is basically a list which contains of, sorry, this should be is a list. So, we will get this list which is z 1, and when we put this into r, we will get r as this is a list. I think you should work it out as an example. By the time we have finished answering yes, so we make two calls to with rule number 2. So, these are like recursive calls, one call to the base clause which is append nil something. At the end of it, we have got this binding that the variable r is bound to this list called this is a list. So, in effect we have ended up appending two lists essentially. So, we try to show that a certain formula is true, but in the process we said yes, that formula can be true provided r is bound to a list which reads like this is a list, which is indeed the list that you get by appending the two input lists essentially. So, this logic program can be used to append two lists essentially. The interesting thing about logic programming is that I gave the third argument as a variable, I could have given the second argument as a variable or the first argument as a variable, and the system would still work essentially. In that sense it is more flexible. We will take up this point and maybe we will revisit this example, or in a slightly different avatar we will see this example, or something which is similar but not quite the same, and see that how logic programming allows us this flexibility of uncovering relations between things. So, where this append a predicate is basically describing a relation between three lists essentially. It is saying when is the first list appended to the second list equal to the third list, that is the relation we are defining by this two formulas. And what Kowalski and his group showed was that such logic sentences can be treated as a logic program, and in fact Prolog is a language which does that, and we will spend the next few classes looking at how do you express things in Prolog and what is the restrictions and so on essentially. Okay. So, we will stop here.